Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of 18 Minutes with 180 Markets. Well, friends, we certainly know markets are tough right now, but that's why it is so important to find those companies and those businesses that have that potentially huge upside, big, big land holdings if you're in the natural resources space, and also in those commodities that are still sought after with big supply-demand imbalances. And that's why I'm thrilled today to be joined by James Wilson of Alchemy Resources, because Alchemy is a company with huge land holdings, which does represent that potentially large upside in critical metals, and also importantly, in that great rule of law location called Australia. And with that introduction, James, welcome to 18 Minutes with 180 Markets.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks for having me today.
Hey, James. People back people, in a couple of minutes, can you just tell us a little bit about your background? How did you get to where you are today?
Yeah, sure. Well, I'm a geologist by background. I started my career in the goldfields of Western Australia in the early 1990s. Dropped off on a plane and straight into Kalgoorlie and burst by fire. I originally started working for Great Central Mines, the Joe Gutnik-driven company, the discovery and the feasibility stages of the Bronzewing gold deposit and the Jundee gold deposit in 1992, I think it was, 1991. And then I worked on those mines as an exploration geologist. The first day of work into 1,000 metres a day of RAB drilling, which was entertaining. Got exposure to the feasibility study and finally ended up being the underground production geologist there, running production on the very high-grade gold mine that it was at Bronzewing. I then moved to work in Africa, in Ghana, the Ivory Coast, and then finally in Guinea. I eventually then moved to China as an exploration geologist, and I'm working on feasibility projects on a number of gold operations. Finally, I moved back to Australia, and I became a mining analyst, where I stayed for the last 15 years or so, analysing projects in the bulks, precious metals, base metals, for retail investors in Australia and institutional investors in North America and Europe. So I've now been in Alchemy now for 3 years as CEO, and it's been an exciting period for the company. We've now discovered critical metals on our projects, which is a really interesting angle. But we also have that base load of gold projects historically and a number of base metals projects in New South Wales, which are very exciting too.
Excellent, excellent. Hey, Jay, and we'll get to all of it, but obviously let's start out with those critical metals, because that is certainly what is in fashion right now. Kaironi, your project, can you just talk to us a little bit about that one? And then we'll get to the other ones as well, of course.
Yeah, sure. So Kaironi sits about 110 kilometers east of Kalgoorlie. It was operated formerly by Silver Lake Resources and Integra before their takeover, looking for gold, and a number of other companies over several decades, I might add. Kaironi itself is around about sort of 1,150 sort of square kilometres, and that's one part of the project. There's a second project to the north called Lake Rebecca, which is another 500 square kilometres. So when you think about it, 1,700 square kilometres or so is an enormous package of land, and a lot of IPOs these days feature probably a third of that in each of those. So it's a big package of land. It's a strategic package which sits along the Keith Kilkenny Shear that goes all the way up to Caruso Dam, which is owned by Northern Star, and also to the Rebecca Project, which is owned by Remelius. And we sit next to an existing gold mine out there too called Aldous, which is owned by Silver Lake Resources. So infrastructure rich. There's big roads that go out there, all weather roads. And Kaironi was always seen as a historic gold project. It was, for the last 50 years or so, people have found gold, operated, and mined gold there. And when I turned up with Alchemy, we put the database together for everything that we had, not just the gold assays. And we collated all that, spent a lot of time on that. And then we started mining our own database to see what was there. And we discovered that there was lithium anomalism. So we hopped on a plane, went out there, and we found a pegmatite. And, we walked the ground. The best thing you can do is get boots on ground. Right. And we found a pegmatite. We sampled it. It didn't have a huge amount of lithium in it at the time, but it had very big pathfinder elements. So, up to sort of 4,000 or 5,000 ppm rubidium, decent tantalum numbers, 20 to 100 ppm tantalum. And these are all significant. These are all sort of can be up to 1,000 times background. So it was interesting. And we did a lot more work. And we've sort of now developed that into a second tier project for Alchemy, which is in tandem with the gold there as well. So the critical metals is really sort of only scratching the surface there, we think.
Right. And speaking of that, scratching the surface, I believe that there is drilling currently underway there. Is that accurate?
We just finished a drill program, but that was for our gold at a Challenger down to the south. We're now planning stages for the lithium, and we have done two drill programs there as well in the last 12 months. So, yeah, we did one drill program that was immediately north of our outcropping pegmatites, and that area was called Hickory. They're all named after smoking woods, if anybody's interested. Hickory and Hickory and Mesquite, because we're barbecue enthusiasts. So, we did one drill program drilling to the north of the outcropping pegmatites. And the complexity that we find with Caroni is that there is outcrops, but then it disappears under sort of like very shallow sand cover. It's only a few meters thick, but it's enough to obscure any geochemical anomalism and outcrop. So they're blind in essence. So we have to use methods like geophysics and literally just getting boots on ground to see where we can see these outcrops, which sometimes can see the, you know, the size of a dinner plate kind of thing. So that's what your sort of your target is. We did the drilling, the first round of drilling, we did actually intercept, you know, meters at 1,000 ppm lithium, meters at, you know, 2,000. I think the biggest one we got was 1 meter at 0.5% lithium. The important thing in this part of the world is that you are in proximity to a fertile granite, which is the Cardunia granite just up the road from us. And that that enables you to understand that you do have metal in the system. So right. Where you get pegmatites, they form in swarms. So where you get one pegmatite, you're going to get more. And perhaps most importantly is we have the Mana discovery, which is a 30 million ton lithium deposit just 8 kilometers up the road on the other side of this same granite. So it's prospective. We have a fertile granite. We did intercept spodumene on our project in our area. And we think it's just a function of just doing more work, more drilling to find that zone of enrichment in the area. So it's quite exciting.
Right. And James, on a neurology side, there are some larger players around you, aren't there?
Oh, that's right. We're in a belt, which is basically the, I guess you can call it the lithium belt, which is to the west of us from Kalgoorlie all the way down to Norseman, which features Mount Marion, which is MinRes, Bald Hill, which might be MinRes fairly soon, I think, and Baldania to the south of that with Liontown. And of course, the most recent acquisition by Develop, which is Essential Metals to the west. They all sit in the greenstone belt, which is that sort of traditional nickel belt to the west of us. The belt we are in with the Keith Kilkenny Shear is a different greenstone belt. The only discovery in that belt at the moment is Mana. There's a number of explorers to the south of us and to the north of us that are having a bit of a win on prospectivity. I think it's Charger as well to the south down in Norseman, but in effect, there has really been no exploration for lithium in our belts ever, as far as we know, besides the discovery of Mana and the work that we are doing at the moment.
Right, but therein lies the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. We've done a lot of regional work in the last 12 months. We did a lot of soil samples down to the south of us, where we discovered anomalism on our Red Oak and our Alder projects. And they sit about, I don't know, probably about 30 kilometres to the south of where we're currently working on the sort of main areas where we found spodumene. And the soil samples came back with broad anomalism. I think at Red Oak, it was about probably 5 kilometres by sort of 8 kilometres, I think. I can firm that up. And then you go to Alder, and Alder was 10 kilometres by 15 kilometres across. And that's the anomaly. So, you know, that takes a fairly significant amount of work to go and have a look at. They're enormous areas. So, you know, it's exciting nonetheless. We have a certain amount of focus at the moment on the more advanced projects, but we are working those slowly in the background, getting Red Oak ground mapping, getting people on ground to take more looks at it, see where the genesis of it is, and seeing where how we can progress them over the next 12 to 24 months. So, yeah, right. Very exciting.
Yeah, and speaking of the timetable, can you give investors a little bit of a timetable? What should they look for over the next 6 to 12 months?
Yeah, well, in Western Australia, we're obviously just completed a drill program at Challenger for gold. That was sort of a legacy target that we did before we started the lithium work. In about 2 or 3 weeks, we should be drilling on the lakes on our Western Brown gold target. And this is really just sort of filling in sort of projects whilst we're progressing other sort of administrative things for the lithium programs. So we'll be drilling on Western Brown in about 2 to 3 weeks, and that's a lakes program. Lakes rigs have become much more available these days, as of drill rigs everywhere, which is really good. So we can sort of put a little short program in there to test a gold target. And then we're also then now progressing the access and heritage surveys to go and be able to go and get in there and do the follow-up lithium program from the most recent one we did a few months back. So there's a fair bit on just in Western Australia alone. And we're just progressing that sort of, you know, aggressive exploration timeline in the region.
Right. Now, you mentioned Western Australia. Why don't we move a little bit east towards the Lachlan Fold Belt? Maybe tell us a little bit about your project over there.
Yeah, it's a really interesting part of the world. New South Wales has really sort of come to the fore recently with the exploration for base and critical metals. We have a number of assets over there with Yellow Mountain Overflow and West Lynn project. And we have, three sort of main projects over there. There's a number of other little assets over there that we work as well. Our projects over in New South Wales are in joint venture with Develop Global, who owns 20% of us, or 20% of our joint venture. And sort of moving from project to project, Yellow Mountain sits about 20 kilometres from Kingston Resources, their Mineral Hill mine, and about sort of 30 kilometres away from Aurelia's Hera mine, along the Gilmore Suture. Yellow Mountain hasn't really been drilled since 1986. There's a number of old shafts there. There's a number of old drill programs that were done there. And when you're talking like, you know, drill results of 24 metres at 1% copper, 1% lead and 1% zinc, from surface. They're not insignificant results to go and look at from surface. There's grab samples there that they took around the old shaft going up to 7.15% copper and 6.5% lead. Obviously, they're not representative because they're just from old ore stockpiles outside, but it does show you the scope of what you're dealing with. So we're doing desktop studies to go and try and understand that, ripping the model apart in preparation for further drill programs. We're just finalizing the land access in there at the moment, and we hope to be drilling probably early next year on that with a bit of luck. Just moving further to the north, we have the Overflow project. Overflow is a sort of a Hera style mineralization. It's gold, high grade gold, lead, zinc, and some silver and copper as well. We currently have a resource envelope we're sort of working on at the moment of about 700 meters of mineralized strike extent. And you get results in there of, you know, one of the old drill holes there, 10 meters at 4.4 grams gold, 3% zinc and 1.3% lead from 160 meters down hole. Other results, you know, some really great results, 4.65 meters at 8.5 grams gold, 13.5% zinc, 71.1% lead and 79 grams silver from 180 meters. So it's a significant target. Cobalt style deposits tend to thicken at depth. So that's sort of like the next phase of drilling will be to sort of drill some deeper diamond holes in there to test how this model works. And we're getting a resource underway for that at the moment. And we hope to have some results on that in the next short period, hopefully. And we'll announce that to the market when we get the results ourselves. So it's quite exciting. And it's a sort of a starting phase for doing more work on there. Once we have a resource model on that, then we can sort of interpret that and see where we go. Furthermore, we have the West Lynn HPA nickel cobalt project, which sits up near Ningen. It's about sort of an hour or so drive up the road from Overflow. It sits 10 kilometres west of Ningen, and we have a 21.3 million tonne nickel cobalt resource there at 0.84 nickel and 0.05 cobalt. It's a weathered serpentinite, so it sits stratiform. It's just sitting flat about, you know, 10 metres under the soil cover, relatively easy to mine. One of the areas on there also has a 7 million tonne at 21% alumina resource. And we've done metallurgy on both of these. And we can achieve almost on the HPA, the alumina, we can achieve a 99.95% product. And that [S2] Wow. [S1] Was done like 4 years ago, you know, so it just requires a bigger sample and more work. And, you know, from my chats with the metallurgy guys, it's about 50 grand. And we should be able to demonstrate a 4N product from that relatively easily, which is in high demand, of course, for sapphire glass and synthetic battery applications. And the nickel cobalt resource is basically sort of a, you know, we've drilled about a third of this serpentinite body, which extends over sort of many tens of kilometres. So it's just more a function of drilling. So, you know, it's an advanced project. We need additional metallurgical test work. There's been different metallurgical test routes that have just since been announced for a number of players in the region, which are cheaper and more effective. So we'll look to apply those. And yeah, there's certainly value to be had in that asset, especially when you get the likes of some of the other bigger players in the region. I think like Freeland's Somerville, sort of down to the south. So yeah, there's a lot of action in the region, a lot of advanced projects for Alchemy there. And yeah, we've got a lot of latent value in these assets, we think.
Yeah. The big theme I'm noticing throughout the whole portfolio, though, is underexplored, that you are in a lot of those locations where really they do require more work, more drilling, and so forth and so on. Is that how you see it as well?
Yeah, that's right. You know, there's only with small explorers and limited cash, there's only certain areas that you either focus on, you know, the critical metals element, we can focus on gold. If we were to focus on all of the assets simultaneously, we'd be spending the equivalent of a mid-tier mining company's exploration budget every year. So that's, you know, you've got to be fairly tactical in how you spend your money. Of course, nickel cobalt is very, very much in focus, but we think that at the moment, the critical metals with lithium is more important in terms of a value generator for shareholders, but we are cognizant that all of the assets have value. And so we're doing a staged approach to that.
Right. And speaking of value, oil drilling does cost money. The balance sheet, though, you are in fairly good funding shape, aren't you, right now?
That's right. We were very, very fortunate that we raised money last year at $5.5 million. So our current cash position is around about $5 million as of the June quarter, and we've only spent, you know, there's been two small drill programs since we've done that, so we're still sticking around sort of that level, which is really encouraging. It gives us a lot of bullets to go and fire in terms of exploration. And our spend is about sort of $500,000 a quarter. So we're spending like, you know, roughly sort of $2 to $2.5 million a year on exploration in the ground. So that funding in its current sense should actually last us some time. That will obviously differ depending on the amount of workload that we push over to New South Wales, which we are considering at the moment. And once we get these land access agreements, then obviously drilling will commence almost immediately on the Yellow Mountain asset. And once we get the resource completed for overflow, we will probably look at doing more work there. So, you know, that figure is sort of probably a baseline figure of about $2.5 million.
Right. Hey, James, I can't resist asking this question now. It's a little bit of a tangent there, but we all see inflation moving up. As far as the cost of mining, a couple of years ago, really, we were seeing rates for rigs up 30, 40%. Can you just give us some context? What are you seeing right now? Because certainly you're in that market.
Yeah, we're very fortunate that the amount of phone calls we're getting for drill rigs at the moment is quite significant. There's a lot of latent capacity around, which is great. We've aligned ourselves with the Raglan guys out of Kalgoorlie, and a bit of a shout out to those guys because they're great. The costs, I would say, haven't really changed much. They've probably come down a little bit. Mobilization rates are probably being thrown into things now. So you're probably looking probably a little bit, you know, maybe 10% cheaper than what you were getting last year. But for us, it's more the availability and we're getting a first class. They're brand new rigs. They're powerful. I'd rather be sitting out there drilling a drill program that takes 10 days to drill rather than being out there for 3 weeks with a bit of old kit. And that's what we're getting. We're getting really good, nimble, fast programs out there, getting steady turnaround of news flow and assays for shareholders and for us. And that's super duper. We've had drill programs before where we've had, you know, it's an older rig, it takes longer to go and complete. So there's a lot of really good gear around at the moment. Like I said before, the lakes rigs, they're unobtainium usually. And we've got one hopefully starting in a few weeks' time. There's, you know, the big wide track mounted rigs that can drive into the middle of water and stuff like that. And they're available. You know, the same rates as normal RC rigs. So that I think, you know, the people costs has come down a little bit. There's a lot more availability of people now. You can afford to be a bit more choosy in terms of sort of where you go with more talent. So no, it's a good market at the moment. We hold onto a small team ourselves. We're nimble. We can start a program in 24 hours.
Amazing.
Camp all the time. We can jump in, fly in, and we're going within 6 hours.
So that's incredible.
We're very fortunate. We call it champagne exploration. Because that's what it is basically. It's we have a camp next to the Stillwell Lake mine, so we can just walk in, start it up, fire the car up, and you're going within a day, which is great.
Got it. Hey, James, we have to keep the interview short. In just the closing remarks, if there was one or two points you'd want every investor or prospective investor to know about Alchemy, what would they be?
I think we are, the first point would be we are very nimble. We spend pretty all of our money in the ground, and we have coverage across pretty much all of the critical metals space, and the base metals and precious metals as well. And so there's a lot of levers that we can pull as a company that could generate significant value for shareholders in the near term.
Right. Hey, James, thank you very much. We look forward to seeing not only the upcoming results, but to see where the future goes with Alchemy.
Thanks very much for having me today.
Bye-bye.